rituals of humiliations. I mean, how much of what accompanies the organization of the work process, you know, it's also meant to break down your dignity even before you begin to work. And in some cases, it's very, very obvious.
Yeah.
You know, I remember, for example, reading about what miners had to go through in the South African mine, because going to work in the South African mine, how they will be forced to take this medical test, you know, where they'll be have to strip themselves naked and stand naked for considerable period of time and then go to the x-ray and et cetera, and it was very clear that all of this was purely to introduce them to a situation like working in the mine where they would have no rights. It had nothing to do really with medical issues. It was one ritual. So in that case, it was very evident. But, you know, reading upon that experience, I realized there are so many other situations that are less visible. And yet, you know, things that many times we associate with bureaucracy or poor organization, but in reality, they are preparing you. You know, it's like in the old days, you know, in Italy, that, or in many countries of Europe, you couldn't get a job unless first you had done your military service.
Right.
And the point of the military service was not preparing you for war, it was preparing you for work.
Right.
Learning you to obey without a reason, without having a reason. You know, so all those ritual humiliation, breaking down the dignity. And that's also at the same time is the place, the breaking point. You know, when people realize that they are basically, they are being dehumanized. You know, their own humanity is at stake. It's also the moment in which many times. And it's like back to the Zapatistas. The Zapatistas have been preparing themselves for the insurrection for a long time, since 1983. You know, and but they, in 1994, they felt that they were not prepared. Or at least a good part of the leadership felt they were not prepared. But then the communities, you know, said, no, we go to war now. We all die, but we go to war. Because right now, we are starving. Right now, a threshold has been reached that we cannot accept to live like this any longer. It doesn't matter if we are defeated. Mm-hmm. We are already defeated. Mm-hmm. If we continue like this, we are already finished. So I think that's really important. About what Gustavo is saying, I think it's very powerful. You know, first of all, yeah, 4 months without police, imagine, you know, and actually, in fact, you know, I think it's an experience we've had in New York, the few times we were so lucky, then the police went on strike. I think that was always the experience, right?
Yeah.
That actually everything went much better when they're out. And that's why I think that those attempts that now some groups are making in the city or other parts of the country, right, to find ways to do justice without turning to the police, right, looking at some of the experience that come from indigenous communities in Latin America, but to actually, you know, habituate ourselves not to turn to the police with the idea that that's where safety is,
yeah.
Right? And find other ways to deal with the problems that emerge in our community. I think that that is extremely, extremely important. Because as we see now, I mean, I think that how can anybody actually think of the police in terms of safety? And, you know, I think that what he's talking about, the Mexico, how in Mexico nobody looks at the police or the state, you know, as a guarantor of our safety. I think that this can be applied to the United States as well, at least for a good part of the population, especially as we know the black population. But I think that the very interesting point also in Gustavo's present, you know, article is the question of basically the community, you know, the importance of the social fabric and the organization. In terms of the struggle, and about the self-reproducing movement. This was something that I don't know if some of you here were around at that time. You know, in the 90s, in the early 90s, after Seattle, you know, after Prague, there was a feeling, you know, among some activists in the city that, you know, there were these big demonstrations, so many people in the street, and a sense of empowerment, and then everything kind of silence for months, nothing would be moving. And we started discussing why, you know, why this is taking place. You know, at the time there were a number of people around ABC in Rio, the Team Color Collective. I don't know if some of you remember those folks, who now are dispersed in different parts of the country. And we started talking about the idea of how do you have a self-reproducing movement, a movement that doesn't continuously have these ups and downs, you know, moments of surge and then disappearance. Why this sense of discontinuity? And one of the discussion was precisely one of the factors that, you know, so many people found was precisely this question of the social relations among people who are joining in a struggle. You know, this the sense of dissatisfaction with the kind of community that was created by the big demonstration, the strategy of the big demonstration. Let's get 100,000 people in the street. You know, that's all very good and it has a place in a struggle, but it's not enough because then you're not connected to those people. You, in a way, your day-to-day life, you go back often home and you are as isolated, you know, as you were before. And so we began to look at what it would mean to have a kind of organization, a kind of movement where you don't have that discontinuity. And of course it had to be a movement where the political moment and the moment of the struggle will not be separated. You know, something which the feminist movement, for example, you know, always believed in. You don't separate your day-to-day life, you know, from the struggle. The struggle has to be rooted. Otherwise, it's not sustainable. You know, that unless it is rooted. And then from that point of view, you also begin to look at what are the forms of organizing? What kind of organization? How do we organize? If those forms of organizing are actually taking into account the needs that people have. And only in that way you can begin to construct those deep relationships with people, you know, that in a way are those that sustain you, particularly in the harsh moment of a struggle. Mm-hmm. They sustain you beyond, you know, the moment when you think, okay, the struggle is winning. And I think that discussion is still extremely important. You know, that, you know, the sense of you know, this deep bonding. Gustavo speaks of the love affairs on the barricades, mm-hmm. right? How the barricades became a moment of great cohesion building, connection between the different generations. Love affairs, you know,